Good morning and welcome to Allen Avenue Unitarian Universalist Church's in-person and online worship. Whether today is your first time here or you've been coming for years, we're so glad you're with us. My name is Katrina Van Brew. My pronouns are she and her, and I'm a member of the board, and also I'm your e-blast person. Thank you. We are a growing community that transforms lives through the power of love. Our mission calls us to celebrate diversity, encourage spiritual growth, and promote social responsibility while we travel on and care for the earth. A special welcome to those who at home who are joining us on Zoom today. If you're attending for the first time, please go to our website and fill out the welcome card so that we can know more about you. We have two announcements today. One is about the lunch today. It says, if you ordered a particular sandwich due to dietary restrictions, please come pick it up in the kitchen. All other lunch bags will be on the long table in the foyer. And we have another announcement. Plans are well underway for our fabulous holiday artisans fair. Yay! Many thanks to all those who have already contacted us. We have several sub-areas that need leadership, as well as more artisans. Tomorrow night, Monday, we will have a Zoom meeting at 6:30 for everyone and anyone who is willing and able to help and participate in this fun, community-building, important fundraiser. The link is in this past week's e-blast, in the Breeze calendar, or you can contact Terry or Celeste, and we'll email it to you. We want your ideas and energy. Terry and Celeste, are you here? So they are right there. You can contact either of them to get the email link. Now we invite you all to take this opportunity to silence your cell phones so that we can be fully present to one another. After the service, grab a cup of coffee. Is that still true even though we're doing the lunch thing? I guess it probably is. After the service, please grab a cup of coffee in the kitchen window and stay for conversation in the foyer or out on the lawn. We encourage you to find someone you've never met before and introduce yourself. Those on Zoom may stay on and connect with one another. And now, let us center our hearts and minds with the ringing of the chimes.
Good morning, church.
Good
to see you. Congratulations on making it through the main marathon detour to make it here this morning. I took a very interesting roundabout way of getting here. And I suspect there might be some people who are on their way taking just such detour. So for those of you I haven't met before, my name is Reverend Tara. I use the pronouns she, her, and they, them. And I'm the transitional minister here at Allen Ave UU Church. And I welcome you, those who have been here a whole bunch of times or much longer than I have, and those of you who have never been here before, welcome. We are so glad to be with you. Today is a special day here at A2U2. After worship, we will gather for the All Church Covenant Workshop, the first step in the process of developing a congregational covenant of right relationship. I want to extend my gratitude in advance, before they disappear into the kitchen, for our lunch crew today, Celeste, Sue, Kate, and Norm. Oh my goodness, thank you. And I want to introduce you as well to our workshop leader, Reverend Erica Barron from the UUA. Erica uses she, her pronouns, and she's a congregational consultant for the New England region of our Unitarian Universalist Association. She'll also be offering our sermon this morning. Prior to working for the UUA, Erica served congregations in New York and Vermont. She's a lifelong UU. And Erica and I have been working together since I started here last summer, and she's been a support to our congregation behind the scenes in more ways than I can count. Thank you, Erica. So, okay, lots of announcements and words today. Let's worship. Our opening words are adapted from Naima Penniman, the program director at Soul Fire Farm. She writes, "We're gonna need to get organized, live beyond boundaries, soften our hearts, talk to each other. We're gonna need to leave behind our baggage, relinquish our comfort, release our control, coexist. We're gonna need to dream bigger, work harder, get dirty, take time. We're gonna need to remember, we're gonna need to forgive. We're going to need to let go. We're going to need to feel fully, revive our intuition, make up our minds, enact change. We're going to need to stay focused. We're going to need to be strong, tend our commitment to beauty, fuel our devotion to truth. We're going to need to pray. We're going to need to trust. We're going to need to give light. We're going to need light. We are light. We are. Come into this space where all are welcome, all are needed, all are loved. Come, you are joyfully called to worship.
As we light our sanctuary chalice this morning, those worshiping at home are invited to light a chalice or a candle near you to connect us to one another. And our chalice lighting words this morning are by Marta Valentin, who also works for the UUA, helping new ministers. As we light our sanctuary, we pause this morning from the chaos of the world to reclaim the beauty within these walls that carries us through our week. We lift this community onto our shoulders with pride and grace-filled expectations for our children and our children's children.
And we light a second candle this morning, a candle of community, holding in our hearts UU Indigenous climate activist Jacob Johns, who is recovering from a gunshot wound from a what was supposed to be peaceful protest in Española, New Mexico. We hold in our hearts all of those on the front lines for justice, fighting for the world we dream of. Will you take a breath with me? Our opening hymn is number 34 in your gray hymnal and up on the screen. Though I may speak with bravest fire. Dale will play it through once, and you're welcome to rise in body or in spirit as we join our voices as one. Lapel mic on. Awesome. Emily and I have a game we're going to play with you this morning, and it involves balloons. So I'm going to hand them to you, Emily. And maybe actually Erica could help us too by taking a balloon. And I was looking for non-latex balloons for my latex allergy beloveds. And they don't really make circular ones, so I got U's instead. Because the Dollar Tree is so amazing. So we're going to play a game, and I want to thank Celeste, because Celeste turned me on to this Time for All Ages game. It's really fun. Everybody knows how to play this game already. All you have to do is get these balloons to the back of the room as fast as you can. On your mark, get set, go. Stop, 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 stop. Stop, wait, 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 wait. You don't know the rules? The balloon can't touch the floor. Bring it back up front. Bring it back up front. All right, kids, I need your help. You got to help us. All right. Okay. Emily, you want to count to three? Yeah, kids are going to start the balloons this time. You ready? Grab a balloon. Yeah. And Emily is going to count to three, and on three, you're going to get the balloon to the back of the room using the rules you already know.
One, two, three.
Whoa, 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 stop, 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 stop. Mike Argandiza, stop. Suzanne Federer, don't you know the rules? You can't carry the balloon. You can't carry it. Bring it back up here. All right, kids, grab a balloon. All right, try again. Try again. Someone who hasn't had the balloon yet. All right, Emily's going to count to three again. And on three, knowing the rules, we already know, get it to the back of the room. All right, Emily. Get it. Get it, get it. Come on. Whoa, 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 stop, stop. So what you didn't know is at least six people have to touch it. So bring it back. Let's try again. Let's try again. Bring it back. All right. Emily, you want to take that one? All right, Erica. All right. All right, we're going to try this one more time. When Emily counts to three, we're going to get this balloon to the back of the room using the rules that we all already know. Ready? Hold on. So, yes, you're holding all three balloons back there. But someone from every generation was supposed to touch the balloon. So I'm really sorry, but not going to happen. Kids, you can keep those. So, Emily and Erica, thank you very much. You can sit down. So, point made, right? It's no fun to play a game when not everybody knows the rules. Have you ever tried to play a game when you didn't know all the rules? In my experience, sometimes it's when I'm playing with the youngest among us, right? Or have you tried to play a game where suddenly someone decides to make up a new rule or not follow one of the rules, even though you didn't agree on it? Yeah, you know. Even if you're playing a cooperative game, a game that's not competitive, like, I don't know, a role-play game, let's say, where people work toward the same goals, everybody has to work together to win. But there are still rules, right? And so think about our congregational life as a playful cooperative game. What helps us to know and understand the rules, the goals, the expectations, the boundaries of the game? Because we have a goal. Our goal is to live out our mission as best we can. It would be super easy if one person could just pick up the balloon, run to the back of the room. But what's the fun in that, right? And so we have guidelines and agreements about how we will be together and how we will play together towards the fulfillment of that mission. Our congregational covenant, as well as other aspects of our organization, helps us to play that game. Our covenant provides clear enough boundaries, transparently communicated, so everyone knows to get moving together how to do that towards our shared goal. But it's flexible enough to allow creativity along the way. So actually, kids, those who have balloons around their necks, let's try one more time with one simple rule that we all know. You ready? You ready for the rule? Get the balloon to the back of the room without letting it touch the floor, without carrying it, with maximum participation. On three, one, two, three. Getting there. Almost there. Blessed be.
In a few moments, some of us are going to leave the sanctuary to attend religious education programming. But first, I invite our lamplighter, Roman, to join me in the pulpit. A lamplighter is entrusted to transfer the light of the sanctuary chalice to the lamp and then go forth to RE spaces where they will light the chalices there. Roman will now light the lamp. I invite those going to RE to follow the lamplighter as we carry the flame, expanding our sacred space.
We are a freely gathered, open, and welcoming faith community supported by your contributions. Each week, one-third of our offering is given away to a nonprofit organization whose mission aligns with our Unitarian Universalist values. This month's Share the Plate recipient is MUSAN, the Maine Unitarian Universalist State Advocacy Network, which is a statewide advocacy and public policy network anchored in UU faith. You can find more information in your order of service. Donations can be made now, as the basket is passed, through the Donate button on our website, or if you are a member, on Breeze. If giving through Breeze, please note if the donation is your pledge or a gift to our Share the Plate. If you are visiting us for the first time this morning, please know that your presence is your gift to us. At this time, our offering will be collected and gratefully received. Thank you.
Hi, my name is John Howard, and this is Jim Mason. We're going to do a reading, which is called A Covenant Invites Relationship by Lisa Ward. A covenant is not a definition of a relationship. It is the framework for our relating. A covenant leaves room for chance and change. It is humble toward evolution. It claims, I will abide with you in this common endeavor. Be present as best I can in our becoming.
This calls for a level of trust, courage, and sacrifice that needs to be nurtured and renewed and affirmed on a regular basis.
A creed creates a static truth, something that does not incorporate new insights and realities.
A covenant is a dance of co-creation, keeping in step with one another in the flow of our lives.
A creed seeks uniformity and a unison voice.
A covenant seeks harmony and a shared voice. Sometimes we may arrive at a unison, but it is not required.
A creed gives authority to the statement.
A covenant gives authority to shared intention.
A creed is a prescription that must be relied on.
A covenant relies on the treasures of shared truth.
The overall trust within this covenant is in the truth, with a capital T, something which no one person can fully see, yet something which each and every person can come to know in glimpses, in another story, in epiphanies. Truth is ever-changing in our seeking to understand because of our limited perspectives. We grow into a deeper sense of the meaning of all things when we take our journeys seriously with full heart and mind.
The courage within this covenant is in the acceptance and celebration of life with all its challenges, pain, ironies, and joys. And the sacrifice within this covenant is in letting go of dogma, of assumptions, of control, and giving over to a greater wisdom which comes to us in bits and pieces.
The task of this covenant is to take responsibility for the freedom we espouse. We know that we are interconnected and that what we do creates ripples of hope or despair, of affirmation or negation. What we do with and for one another is powerful and beyond our imagining.
Together.
I talk about covenant a lot. I mean, as a person who has been trying to explain and practice Unitarian Universalism for most of my life, it tends to come up quite a bit. And often when I'm talking about covenant, someone will say to me, "I know you're not talking about marriage, but," and then go on to describe something they learned about living in covenant from their own marriage. And usually I say, "Well, I'm not talking about marriage. In fact, personal relationships, including romantic relationships, other family connections, and friendships, are the contexts where I have learned how to be in covenant with other people, even though only some of those relationships actually have a formal covenant." When I was in middle school and high school, my best friend was an evangelical Christian named Elizabeth, and I was an atheist UU. For both of us, our theological commitments were really important and completely opposite. So one of our favorite activities was to debate each other about religion and all its implications. And being the earnest teenagers we were, there were lots of implications. In the 7 years of our friendship, we never ran out of topics. And part of our style of debate was to find and exploit any weakness in each other's arguments and tease each other about them in ways that would have been offensive and cruel in some contexts. But for us, these little barbs were part of the banter of our friendship, and that friendship was actually built on a deep well of affection and respect for each other. Now, years later, I met Rachel, the woman who I eventually married, and when Rachel and I were first getting to know each other and establishing the communication style of our relationship, she let it be known that any sort of teasing like this was not okay with her. And she found it cruel and undermining, regardless of the intent behind it. So it's not part of the way we talk to each other. My father is one of 9 siblings in his family, and as each of them found partners and brought them into the family, this was accompanied by a sort of testing that often included pranks of various kinds. And that was ultimately cemented by over-the-top shenanigans with the car that a couple would be leaving their wedding from, in. So decorations, yes, but also birdseed stashed in various places and all one time filled completely with balloons, all kinds of things. Now, some couples in the family have gone to great lengths to prevent this shenanigans with cars, including locking them. Once that became possible, the inside of the car stuff tended to go away. Some have like hidden them in other people's driveways and whatever, but we always find them. Except for at my sister's wedding, where the photographer's car looked exactly like the car and got accidentally decorated instead. Now, when I married Rachel, I was the first person in my extended family to marry someone of the same gender. So I kind of wondered if the car thing would happen or not. And I was relieved and grateful that our car got the same treatment as everyone else's at their weddings. In fact, because we had a sort of DIY wedding, we had to bring 2 cars to our wedding location, and they both got decorated. It felt like a way of saying that our wedding was as real as the other weddings in the family. On the other hand, I have a friend who every year in late March writes an impassioned, lengthy Facebook post asking everyone not to prank him on April Fool's Day. To him, pranks are always mean-spirited and make him go through the world anxiously expecting something awful. It feels to him like organized pranks are a way of ganging up on someone and making them a target. Did you know that different cultures have different speaking rhythms that indicate respect and disrespect? So in my culture, broadly Northeast American white middle class, the way to show engagement and respect in a conversation is to wait until the other person stops talking, and then you start talking pretty much immediately. Sometimes if we're talking about something particularly difficult, either logistically or emotionally, there might be longer pauses as we try and figure out what to say, but that's not typical in ordinary chat. And occasionally we might overlap our speech, but that's usually accidental. Or it happens when someone really is trying to dominate the conversation and shut the other person down. Now, in other cultures, respect is shown by a significant pause between one speaker and the reply. And in yet other cultures, the way to express interest and engagement in the conversation is to slightly overlap the end of the other speaker. Now, I learned this back in my first ministry. So there was a particular group in the congregation, I honestly can't remember what it was anymore, that met about once a month at a member's house about a 20-minute drive out of town. And one of the other people in the group lived in town near me, so we used to carpool. So on that like 20-minute drive, naturally, we would chat along the way. And the other person was always interrupting me. I mean, just constantly. And I interpreted this to mean that she didn't really care what I had to say, and I tended to just stop talking at some point. Then I learned this thing about how cultures are different in this way, and that she comes from one of the cultures that does the slightly overlapping thing. In this case, Ashkenazi Jewish culture. And once I learned that, for her, the slight overlap meant to indicate interest and engagement rather than disrespect. It felt better, but it still required a massive effort on my part to continually reinterpret what I was experiencing, and honestly, just to get a word in edgewise. When I learned that Rachel experienced the teasing style of communication as hurtful, I could have insisted that I didn't mean it that way and asked her to reinterpret those comments every time I made them. And this is actually a thing that people do a lot, right? It often looks like saying someone is too sensitive or that they can't take a joke. And I could have done that in this case, but I care about Rachel a lot. So I didn't want to be hurting her all the time, even if I'm not intending to. Also, she probably wouldn't have married me if I hadn't. I want her to feel safe and affirmed in our relationship, so I don't engage in that particular style of communication. And in this case, that was a relatively easy thing to change. Want to know what was harder? Changing how I act when things are hard, especially in times of disagreement and conflict. I don't know about you, but I was never taught how to fight well. I mean, I grew up in Unitarian Universalist congregations. I was still never taught how to fight well. I was taught how not to fight, right? That hitting, biting, kicking, etc., are not appropriate, responsive to conflicts in relationships. And neither is being mean with my words. In other words, using words to be deliberately cruel. Beyond that, I think the only skill I was deliberately taught for actively navigating conflict before I was an adult was compromise. In other words, I get some of what I want and you get some of what you want, and to make things fair, that's done in a pretty mathematical way, right? We are going to divide the cake in half. It was a rule in my house that whoever cut the cake in half, the other person got to choose, so that it would be all mathematically fair. The conflicts I faced as an adult have mostly been too complicated for the simplistic tool of mathematical compromise to solve. And honestly, so were most of my childhood conflicts. I just didn't have another way to do it. I've encountered many other tools that people use to try to navigate conflict as an adult. You might recognize some of these as tools you've learned to use yourself or have had used on you. One tool is the continued reliance on mathematical compromise. And this tends to make every conflict, and sometimes even every interaction in every relationship, an entry in some imagined ledger of debt and surplus. And conflicts are solved by asserting debt and exacting payment, or very much more rarely, by admitting indebtedness and offering concession. Another tool is the logical argument. This is a favorite one of my family too. Conflicts are won by asserting that the emotional needs of the other parties to the conflict are insignificant, or failing to notice them altogether, and by hiding one's own emotional needs behind a veil of reasoned argument. This often actually comes with an inability to notice and tend to one's own emotional needs as well as the others. And there are lots of other tools that we use in conflict. Emotional manipulation, which usually works by making the other feel guilty until they give in to what you want. There's remaking the rules, as we learned this morning, in which we just change the standard being applied to any situation until it works for us. My favorite tool for much of my life was withdrawal. So you allow the other person to win the conflict by getting what they want, and letting the other win in every conflict, they always get what they want, until the day I decide that the continued negation of my own wants and needs is not worth it, and this is followed by the more decisive withdrawal in the form of ending the relationship. Then I met Rachel. And I had finally come to the end of my own willingness to disappear my own wants and needs in a relationship, and I didn't want to withdraw from my relationship with Rachel. I became committed to her, to connection with her, to building a life with her, and to a real, equal partnership between the two of us. And that meant we had to learn to go through conflict within the context of our commitment to each other. We didn't do this very well at the beginning. We moved in together, both left jobs, I started two new jobs, we moved states, and I got ordained, all in the space of 2 weeks. I don't recommend it. Now, one of the tactics I know I used early in our relationship was the tactic of saying whatever will be the strongest argument to get my way. I think I used the logical argument tactic too, because that's what I grew up with. And of course, trying the mathematical compromise thing. We also had some really absurd fights that were about small, mundane things, which were actually about deeper fears and insecurities for both of us. And yet, we still wanted to be together. So we had to learn to do better. And gradually, with the help of a couples counselor, we did. Now, the details of that process are unique to us, of course. For me, though, the thing I learned by engaging in conflict in my primary relationship was how to bring my most important values and commitments into conflict. I value fairness. That means I have to apply the same standards equally in a conflict. I can't just change the rules whenever I want to. I value honesty. That means I need to acknowledge it when my partner says something true that is hard to hear. And it means I have to admit it when I am wrong. I value equality. That means I can't get my way all the time, but it also means I can't give way all the time. Most of all, though, I value this person, my partner. And because I love her, and I want the way we go through conflict to move us toward each other at the end of the day, rather than pushing us apart. So to do that, I need to be transparent, to show her what's really going on for me, which means I need to figure out what's really going on for me. Practicing my covenant, my commitment to my wife, over the course of years has made it easier to notice when I'm getting angry about something that is not the real thing. It's made it easier to stop before I say something just to win and decide to say the more vulnerable, truer thing instead. It has made it easier to stop when she hits on something true that I hadn't considered and to take it in and to let it change my mind. Now, I do not do any of this perfectly, even after 16 years. But as author T. Thorne Coyle says, practice makes possible. So it gets more possible the more I practice. Congregational communities are another place where we practice covenant. Within congregations, we sometimes think of covenant as a thing, a set of promises that we write together and which we remind ourselves of, hopefully at regular intervals. I know in my experience as a Unitarian Universalist lay leader and minister, I often thought of our congregational covenants as actually quite fragile. As a set of promises, they could be broken, and regularly were, whenever we failed to live up to a perfect ideal of what those promises mean. Maybe it was this seeming demand for perfection that led to another thing I regularly witnessed, which is covenants languishing in drawers and files and never made alive in actual interactions in the congregation. So the idea of a covenant not as a thing, but as a practice, not something we make, but something we do, has been a really important shift in my thinking. In congregations, we make commitments to each other and then we practice them. Sometimes this is easy. Sometimes there is the simple joy in a community doing good work together. But just as in my marriage or in any other long-term relationship, there are also moments of tension, challenge, and conflict. And then we have to practice our commitments to each other. Covenant as a practice feels much less fragile than covenant as a thing, at least to me. When I imagine covenant as a set of promises, in my mind's eye, I see a glass bowl. Beautiful, capable of holding whatever I need it to hold, but only until it is inevitably dropped and broken. Covenant as a practice feels more like maintaining my house. There is always a to-do list, it never goes away. Small things break or need attention pretty much all the time, but the structure is still sound, and the more I work to fix the small things, the more I learn about how to take care of the big things, and I know when to call the plumber and not attempt it on my own. And the house stands through all of this. It's a good thing that we have a strong house because covenants can be hard work, especially in a diverse community. Let's say I'm sitting in a board meeting and the discussion is flowing freely, but there's someone that keeps interrupting everyone else. Is that because they don't care about what everyone else is saying? Could be. It might also be that they're using that conversation style of slightly overlapping. Maybe I express frustration about something and someone else makes a joke. Are they trying to release some of the tension as a way to indicate that we can both still belong even in difficult moments? Maybe. Or are they trying to make light of my concerns? Also possible. What if the way that one person indicates affection feels like cruelty to someone else? What if the way some people express belonging feels like targeted exclusion to someone else? Who does the hard work of continuous reinterpretation? Is it just the style held by the majority of people in the congregation? We often default to that, but if so, we're not really making space for a diversity of cultures and experiences among us. Now, all of that is hard enough when things are going well, but when we're in conflict, it all gets harder. It's harder to let go of the unfair fighting tactics that we've picked up along the way, which means it's a lot more likely that we are actually intending something less than kind in our interactions, which makes it harder to give each other the benefit of the doubt about our different styles, which makes us all feel unfairly attacked. Cool, so let's just not ever be in conflict, okay? Yeah, that should make all of this covenant stuff easier. I had a friend in seminary who used to say that she was starting her own denomination because wherever two or more are gathered, there is conflict. And I mean, she's not wrong. Somewhere along the way, I learned a definition of conflict that feels accurate to me. So conflict is when two or more people want things that are mutually exclusive, or at least they think the things they want are mutually exclusive, and the people have feelings about it. They are invested in some way. That's it. That's the definition. Two people want different things or disagree about something that matters to both of them. So I'm sorry to say that, yes, at some point in every community, in every relationship, wherever two or more people are involved, heck, even sometimes when only one person is involved, conflict will happen sooner or later. In fact, in a community dedicated to diversity of culture and experience, committed to freedom of conscience and promoting a responsible search for truth and meaning, if we never disagreed, that would seem to imply we are not actually living our values. We are going to disagree. We just are. So now what? How do we practice covenant in a congregation through times of ease and joy, times of misunderstanding and culture clash, and times of deep disagreement? Well, first, it's helpful to know what we are committed to together, such as we are committed to each other, to certain values like justice, equity, pluralism, interdependence, and love, and we are committed to treating each other with respect, compassion, and fairness. Then, when we are able, we can practice transparency and curiosity. So transparency is about letting each other into our different experiences. It might look like, that comment made me feel discounted, or when you get quiet like that, it feels threatening to me. And curiosity is about seeking to understand each other, such as, when you start talking before I'm done talking, what does that mean to you? Or, what lets you know that you belong? How can I help you feel that sense of belonging in this community? And finally, when there are hard conversations and conflict, we can remind ourselves and each other of our core commitments. I am committed to love. What is the most loving thing I can do right now? Or, we are committed to treating each other with respect. How can I demonstrate respect to you in this disagreement? And then we can choose to do the loving thing, the thing that someone else will feel respected by, the fair thing, as often as we can. That will not be all the time, because we're not perfect. And no amount of practice is going to make us perfect, no matter what the proverb says. But practice will make it possible to act according to our values and covenants more often and in more ways. So covenant is not easy. It's actually quite difficult at times, but it is the path towards being in community together and living our values together. So I invite you into the adventure that is covenant. And now I invite you to arise in body or spirit for our next hymn, which is number 131, Love Will Guide Us, up here or in the gray hymnal.
Invitations to help us navigate the beautiful chaos that will ensue after the postlude. For those of you on Zoom, the Zoom Covenant Workshop will begin at 11:30 on this same link and run until about 12:30. Please consider staying even if you did not RSVP. Between now and 11:30, you may stay for Zoom coffee hour and conversation, or turn your camera off to get a snack and take a bio break. Susie, I saw your email. I haven't responded yet. The answer to your question is if there's an uneven amount of people, just make a group of three. For those here in the sanctuary, after Dale and Sam and Mike finish the postlude, those of you who are staying for the workshop are invited to make your way into the foyer and grab your lunch. If you did not sign up for the workshop and would like to stay, please do. You'll join the small groups happening here in the sanctuary. If you are staying and you didn't sign up ahead of time and you want to be in a group with all people wearing masks, please go to the boardroom. If you can't stay, please feel free to connect with one another on the benches outside the front entrance. After you pick up your lunch, folks who are staying, please find a place to sit and eat inside or outside. And around 11:30, I know we're running a little behind. We'll just figure it out. I'll come running around and telling you. Around 11:25, 11:30, maybe 11:35, you can clean up and find your small group room. There are names on all the doors, and if you don't want to walk around or walking around the whole building to find your spot is too much for you, find me and I will tell you I have the list. Now, let's take one more breath together. As we prepare to move from worship into the rest of the day, our worship has ended and our service begins. Go in peace.